Are we ready?
Hi everybody, my name is Lauren Donenfeld. I am an Emory alum and I debated for Emory starting as a novice and then eventually competing in varsity. And then I also am now the director of debate at Alpharetta High School, where we've had some success and a lot of really great students. And I also coached for a year at Vanderbilt when I was in grad school there. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about what it means to be affirmative, and specifically what it means to be affirmative on the China topic. So I think there are definitely some things you want to think about. I want to talk first about what it means to be a good AF debater. So good AF debater is prepared, or honestly any debater, right? You want to have some blocks written in advance. You want to be thinking about what are the major arguments that link to my AF that people could read. And I think, you know, a lot of people have different variations of the same arguments. They might have a different impact card or a different link card, but their arguments, you know, are pretty much going to be fairly similar and consistent against an AF. There's only so many T violations you can read against an AF or a DeZet or counterwinds or whatever. So good debaters, and especially good AF debaters, are prepared. They spend time thinking about how they can write blocks to kind of defend the house. You will be able to use your prep time much more efficiently if you have some pre-written blocks, right? I'm a big fan of 2AC blocks, right? Saves a lot of time. You don't have to think about what am I going to say to this DeZet. You've got some stuff ready to go, and it makes it a lot easier. So definitely writing blocks. Other things good AF debaters do is that in round they manage their prep time, they converse with their partner, they talk to them. The 1AR is a pretty hard speech if you're a 2A and your partner's to give the 1AR. You want to make sure that you're kind of consistent and you talk about what arguments do I want extended into the later rebuttals of the speech, and what arguments could win me the debate and where could I lose the debate. And I think when you're making decisions as a debater, and especially, you know, on the AF, you want to think about what are the arguments that are going to make the judge vote in favor of me or vote against me. And sometimes it's not really even a matter of being better at it, it's just convincing the judge that you know what you're doing and that you're taking out some of those dissads or counterplans or whatever the neg is reading. Other things I think about for being a good AF debater is that you do some practice rounds. You never ever want to break a new AF when you have not done a practice round on it. So I know that can sometimes be hard if you don't really have anyone you can debate against, or you know, you don't really have a coach or someone like that, but I do think it's important that before you break a new AF, you have some practice on it. That's why at Alpharetta, we were, you know, whenever we have new AFs coming out, we try to schedule after-school practice rounds. Before our first tournament of the year, we try to give everybody one AF round and one neg round with their partner at the first tournament so that we can practice some of those things we need to practice. So that's important to know how to choose a good AF, right? Lots of AF choices. So true story, my senior year, we went... I think we lost all of our AF rounds at GSU, and I was like, well, that didn't go very well. We might need to rethink our strategy. And I switched to an AF that I did a lot of the research on. It was kind of based off an AF another school was reading, but I just liked it a lot more, and I understood it, and I was more interested in the research. And at the next tournament, which was just about 3 weeks later at Kentucky or so, we won 3 out of our 4 AF rounds. We only lost to a team that I think later got a first round of the NDT that year. So definitely choosing the right AF can make a big, big difference. You know, one thing to think about is you want it to be almost like a date, right? You want your AF to be someone that you're interested in and someone you can defend from attacks against your opponent. Just like if you're choosing a prom date, you want it to be someone that you are interested in and that your parents are, will not, you know, hate, right? Go with it. So definitely choosing a good AF. There's some arguments about why you might want to choose kind of a big stick AF. It's pretty easy to research, right? I mean, on last year's topic, a lot of people reading variations of different metadata AFs, and that research was not as hard to do as the smaller strategic AFs because there's just a lot more lid on it, but it also means people are going to do more research against it if it's a common AF. Another thing is that there might be an advantage to writing a smaller AF, because if you have a tricky kind of smaller strategic AF, you probably would want to flip AF in Elim so that people do not have as much game on it. For example, there was literally a team my freshman year on the Middle East topic that was reading an AF about sheep in Afghanistan. People were not doing research to it because statistically they were one team, big tournaments, and then when people hit them, they, I think, won a big percentage of their AF rounds, probably more than they maybe otherwise would have because they had a really strategic AF. But it's also harder to research the smaller strategic AFs, so you want to make sure that it's something that you're interested in that you can do a good job researching. I think one thing to think about as well is whether you want to write your own AF or you want to use kind of a camp AF. There's definitely some DAs and advantages to both. So if you have a camp AF, a lot of the research is done for you, and that's definitely nice to think about because you get to do less work. But if you are using a camp AF, you probably haven't done most of that research yourself, so you probably don't know the cards as well. I think a really good way to get to know cards and the arguments for and against each AF are to just simply do the research yourself. So And you got to think about what you want to do, and it definitely helps if you have someone who can help you think about what would be a strategic F for you, what would be something you can write well, maybe look over the blocks you're writing and the cards you're cutting and think about whether or not that is, you know, applicable or whether or not they think that makes sense. Definitely always helps to have, whether you're F or neg or whatever, you definitely want to have a mentor in debate and someone who can help you. And if you don't have one, you feel free to email me, and I'm happy to do that. My email is ldonnan@gmail.com, or just Google Lauren Donenfeld email, and I'm sure it would come up. Okay, the other things about an F is the stock issues. So they are generally solvency, harms, inherency, topicality, and significance. I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on this. I think they get covered a lot in novice debate, and they generally become less relevant as you go on, because other than like T, because people generally do not construct Fs that, for example, have inherency problems. So you want your F to be able to solve a problem. It's like pretty straightforward. It doesn't really do anything. The cards don't say it will help. That's a problem. You want it to solve a major harm or issue, right? No one would really care that much about an F that, like, you know, saved a caterpillar or something like that, right? You want to have it be something that's like solving a major issue or alleviating something that's bad. You want to not have inherency problems, right? You don't want it to already be happening, because if the F is already basically taking place, right, then that would be problematic for you to access your advantages, because it should have already made those advantages happen. You definitely want it to be topical. I think, obviously, there's people who read non-topical Fs, and that's like a different lecture, but definitely something to think about is whether or not your F has something to do with the resolution, whether it's an example of the resolution is usually the definition, right? So you think about the resolution about diplomatic or economic engagement with China, and then you want to think about whether your F is an example of that, that kind of thing. Then you also want it to be significant. That kind of goes with harms, right? You want it to be solving something that's like a big issue. I think throughout the year, people will read a lot of different Fs, but generally, in order to prepare for your first tournament, you want to think about what major Fs people might be reading. And a good way to look at that is to see what the major camps are putting out. So what evidence did Emory put out? What about Northwestern or Sanford or UGA or HSS or SCI or a bunch of other camps, and see what evidence people are putting on. That's usually pretty readily accessible once they get posted. I think specifically the NDF, the South China Sea F, that a lot of people are going to use this year is about basically solving two major advantages. The first one is about the South China Sea conflict, right? So basically in the status quo, which means what's happening now, China's sort of slowly taking pieces of the South China Sea, and they're building islands there, like literally building islands and creating small airports and sending their fisher people into those areas to sort of lay claim to it. And there are some cards that say that's like probably not a good thing about them projecting their power, and it's making other countries uneasy. And then the second advantage is about military-military exchanges, and it basically says that the U.S. will create military talks with, bilateral military talks with China. So the F functionally does two things. It tells China to stop expanding and into the South China Sea, and it also sets up these permanent kind of military-military exchanges to talk about issues that are happening. So that's kind of the F that people at the end of your reading this year, and, you know, I think it's a good F. There's other Fs certainly that are also good. I'm sure people will put out this year. I think other Fs people might read this year might have to do with engaging North Korea, engaging China to solve North Korea, because both China and the U.S. perceive North Korea as a major threat, right? Kind of unpredictable dictator is not a great thing to have in the region or anywhere. Other Fs people might read, I guess we'll kind of see throughout the year. I do think one thing, if you're prepping for a tournament and it's before the first tournament, which is always kind of uncertain about what people are going to say, you might want to think about prepping some international actor counterplan blocks. And by that I mean things like having the European Union or the United Nations do the plan. I would not be surprised if that was a fairly big counterplan this year, because I think it would avoid a lot of the elections problems and elections disads, but that's probably another story. So anyway, those are just some thoughts on what it means to be F. Again, if you have any questions, I would be more than happy to talk to you about it. You can send me an email, or just, you know, contact someone at Emory and they can give you my email address. And I hope that you have a wonderful debate season, that you not only win rounds, but you learn some things and you enjoy it and you become more of a critical thinker. And I have no doubt that if you're, you know, learning about the topic and doing prep work, that you're already taking a great first step. Thanks so much for listening. All right.
Yep.
All right.